In the last video, we talked about having a computing module doing the computing, and some memory units holding the inputs, temporary inputs and outputs, connecting them through public bus. Then the job of computing is simply turning on these memory units in sequence to move electricity around. The button click provides electricity to the transistor inside, allowing electricity in or out. In this video, we will automate these button clicks by building a sequencer. It has a series of wires that will turn on for a short duration in sequence. It's based on the stepper from an excellent book, but how do it know? To have these wires turned on in sequence, we need an input trigger to start a chain reaction. But if it's connected to all the wires directly, they will turn on at the same time. We need a device between the two wires to delay this input by a certain amount of time. If we're able to design such a device, it can be used between the next two wires, taking previous output as input, creating another lag between these two. Same devices can be used between all the wires, creating the chain reaction. How to design such devices? They need to listen to a timing device in order to produce a delayed response. The timing device in the computer is a CPU clock. The CPU clock is a big topic by itself, I will explore more in the future. But right now let's focus on what it does, ticking high-low, high-low at a steady frequency. Connect the clock signal to the device. How can we get it to pass the trigger once clock ticks high? We need a device that can take two inputs. So logic gate comes to my mind first. Turns on the second wire when clock is high. But once the clock ticks low, the wire will be off, unable to support the chain reaction. So we need a memory device. Not only it turns on, but also stays on, even when the clock ticks low. Say we want the lag to be a full clock cycle, or two ticks time. We need two memory units. But the moment the first one passes the input, the second one needs to wait a bit. So we connect an inverted clock signal, so that these two are always opposite. When the first one passes the input, the second one blocks it. Then, the second one passes it when the clock ticks low. So we can insert these pairs between every two wires. The first one to the clock, the second one to the inverted clock. So each tick is pushing the input through one unit. It takes two ticks to turn on each wire. Then, to have wires turned on in sequence for only short duration of time, two neighboring wires are used to drive the final output wire through an AND gate. Using an inverter, the output will be turned off once the next wire turns on. Let's see if it works. When we first start, input is high, all the memories are low. These inverters will keep one hand of the AND gates high. So input can turn on the first wire. When clock ticks twice, second memory turns on, shutting off the first wire, turning on the second one. Each two ticks turn on an output wire for one clock period. These series of wires can power multiple steps of one computing task. So to do more than one computing operation, the cycle needs to repeat itself. So this final wire works as a reset signal, saying that the task is finished, start again. It needs to do two things. First, a new cycle starts, hence turn on the first wire. Then reset all the memories to low. Because with them being high, these output wires cannot be turned on. To turn on the first wire, connect the reset to the first gate. But one high is unable to turn on the AND gate, so we need an OR gate. To reset all the memories to low, invert the high signal to low to be passed through all of them. But this low needs to move through immediately instead of one by one. Hence, these memory units need to be controlled by either the clock or the reset. So we use OR gate for control. The high reset signal turns on OR gate, overtaking clock signal. The low input will flow through almost instantly because the signal travels at the speed of light. Once reaching the end, the reset goes low, turning off one hand of the OR gate. So now, the first output listens to the other hand. It will be turned off when the second wire turns on. This low reset signal also puts the high input back on. It also allows the clock to be in control again. The cycle will repeat over and over. So far, the logic sounds alright. If all these memory units start low when we first apply power. But there is no guarantee. Say, if these two start high, then two output wires will be on at the beginning, powering certain steps of the operation, messing things up. So external control is needed, going through OR gate, serving as initial value. These external signal will also go to the control OR gates below to allow the initial input flow through. So when first apply power, this control signal will be on for a very short period of time, initializing all the units. Then the regular cycle takes over. Plug in the sequencer. Say if we want to add these two, we just let out the electricity data striking the ALU. So first we send electricity from here to here. So we connect the first target to output and the other to input. I put the output wire on the left, input wire on the right to make it easier to see. When the step wire turns on, the sender will put data on the bus and the receiver will accept it. But the data is unstable at the beginning and towards the end. You want to draw data when it's stable. So we need additional timing signals for fine-tuning. One for the output timing, one for the input timing. Both targets need to be controlled by the step wire and the timing wire. So we use AND gate here. These two timing signals are also ticking high-low, but with slight differences. The output timing wire will turn on the same time as the step wire. So the sender will output data to the bus immediately. But the input timing wire will turn on a bit later. It will also go off earlier than the other two, shutting the door of the receiver before data go offline. So we're drawing the data during the middle portion, which is more likely to be stable. So the first operand will be moved here during the first step, holding the first input towards the ALU. So now, connect the second input to the second step wire and the output timing signal. During the second step, ALU will see both operands, splitting outputs. But only one is right. So you allow the correct one to output by connecting the buffer to the step wire. Then, connect the temporary result holder ACC to store the output. Don't forget the fine-tuning wire to make sure we draw data when it's stable. Last step, connect ACC and the final result holder, storing the result here. So using this sequencer, series of actions are automated. But now the problem is, users have no choice in deciding which inputs to operate on, and which result to pick, because they are all hardwired. This brings us to the next topic on instruction, an invention that gives users the freedom to choose what to do and not what.